Good morning to everybody. I am Francesco Sivo, and I'm a PhD student in the University of Bari, and I am affiliated also to the NFN in Bari. And today I'll talk about characterization of axion fluxes from different supernova progenitors. Let's start with a brief introduction on the so-called strong CP problem, which is a well-known problem of the QCD Lagrangian, where we have this CP violating term, which is the one that we can see in the upper part of the slide. And this term is proportional to a certain parameter theta, which is supposed to be related to the neutron electron dipole moment, dn. From experiment, we have a strong upper bound on dn. So we can give a strong upper bound also on this theta parameter. The question is, why is theta supposed to be this small? A possible solution was proposed by Peche and Quinn in 1977 through the so-called Peche-Quinn mechanism, which introduces a new global U1 symmetry, which is the Peche-Quinn symmetry, that dynamically minimizes this parameter theta, and it's spontaneously broken at a certain scale, which is called F of A or Peche-Quinn scale. From this spontaneous symmetry breaking arises a new massless pseudo-scalar Nambu-Goldstone boson called axion, which, since it has a relation and a coupling with pions, it acquires a small mass. Let's say that this small mass, it is related to the Peche-Quinn scale, so the energy scale of the theory. And it is important for axion. But if we introduce axion-like particles, which are particles on other theories like string theory or beyond standard model theories, that arises in the same way, so we call axion-like particles, these new particles, in principle, they don't have any relation between their mass and the energy scale of the theory. So we can't use that relation that we can use on axion. On the other hand, in principle, they can interact with all the standard model particles, but in our minimal model, we will take into account only their coupling with photons, which is related to the Lagrangian term, which is in the left-hand side of the slide, where GA gamma is the coupling constant. Through this Lagrangian term, we can introduce two different processes. The first one is the Primakov process, which we use in the stellar plasma in order to produce axion and axion-like particle from the interaction between photon and fluctuating electric or magnetic field generated by the charged particle in the plasma. And a possible process which is opposite to this one, which is the Alps photon conversion in a large coherent magnetic field, like, for example, an astrophysical magnetic field. Then we take as sources for our axion-like particles core collapse supernovae. What are these core collapse supernovae? We know that a core collapse supernovae is the terminal phase of a massive star life. For massive, we expect it to be at least 8 solar masses. This is a bound relation related both to experiment and to simulations, where most of the energy of the progenitor mass is ejected from a shockwave, and in this shockwave, most of the energy is emitted under the form of neutrinos and antineutrinos of all flavors. The percentage is between 98 and 99%. Then there are two different possibilities at this point. The first one is the success of the explosion, which is the successful core collapse supernovae. And the second one is where the gravitational pull is so strong that the mass collapse onto himself and the star become a black hole. It is well known that we don't actually know the exact percentage of successful core collapse supernovae and failed ones, as we can see from the plot in the lower part of the slide, where the red lines are the successful ones and the black lines are the failed ones. It depends on different models, so we don't know actually what is the actual percentage in reality. So in this supernova, it is possible to easily evaluate the Primakov rate, which is the rate of the Primakov process production, which is just the gamma term in the central part of the slide. As we can see, it is proportional to the coupling constant squared, to the temperature, and it is related to the term, which is Ks, which is an appropriate screening length. Usually, we take into account only the contribution of protons as target for this conversion. But since from the point of view of the abundances, the alpha particles are also a possible valuable target in this case, we need to take into account also alpha particles, and their contribution is evaluated in the value of Ks itself. As supernovae models, we have taken different supernovae models. For 1D spherically symmetric state of art supernovae models, which are the 8.8, the 11.2, 18, and 25 successful core collapse supernovae models, and other two which are failed ones, one from the same type of the previous ones, which is the 40 solar masses model, and the second one, which is a 17 solar masses 3D simulation. As we can see from the plots, both the temperature and the density inside the star are strongly related to the model. Of course, we expect that both the temperature and the density diverges when the star becomes a black hole for the failed supernova, core collapse supernovae models. At this point, we evaluated the so-called ALPS energy spectrum. It is important to say that we expect as a production an higher production for example, failed supernovae models where the temperature is supposed to be divergent, for example. But what we understand is that due to the shortness of these processes, the production is actually lower than the others, as we can see from the plot in the left-hand side, where the 17 solar masses model is at least a couple of order of magnitudes lower than, for example, the 25 one, which has a mass which is one third of the 70 solar masses almost. Then, since space-time near the core is strongly tilted, we need to take into account also the effect of the gravitational redshift, both on the energy and on the time dilatation. Since we are integrating over time, we are interested only in the energy, in the energy spectrum, we take into account only the redshift on the energy, which is expressed by the relation E equal to E star times that exponential term, which is related to the zero-zero component of the matrix. It is important to say also that we don't actually evaluate the matrix analytically. We have it through the direct numerical integration of the Einstein field equation, the simulation itself. Then what we have tried to do is to extrapolate some kind of trend for the fit parameters of the energy spectrum itself. Let's say that we have four different successful core collapse supernovae models, and so we can try to evaluate a linear behavior for their parameter. On the other hand, we have only two failed core collapse supernovae models from two different kinds of simulations. So we didn't take into account a possible behavior, general behavior for them. We can do it with more models, for example. At this point, it is possible to evaluate the so-called ALPS flux from all cosmic supernovae, which is the so-called diffuse supernovae ALP background, or DSN-ALPB in order to be short, which is expressed by the redshift integral that we can see in the lower part of the slide. Where Z is the redshift, then we have some term related to standard cosmology, for example, DT. And we have the redshifted energy, ALPS energy spectrum, which is the NACC in DE, And the last term that we need to take into account is the supernova explosion rate. As I said before, we don't actually know the exact percentage of successful core collapse supernova model and failed ones. So we have to divide the evaluation of the redshifted energy spectrum between exploding ones and failed ones, evaluated also through the so-called IMF, which is the initial mass function phi of m. In our model, it is proportional to m to the to minus a parameter, and this parameter has an uncertainty rate range given by experiments. Then, in literature, it is well known that the percentage should be between 10% and 40% of black hole forming supernova overall supernovae. So we take four different sample cases, which are 10%, 20%, 30%, and 40%, which are evaluated in the plots in the lower part of the slide. It is important to say that as we can see, as the percentage of black hole forming supernovae growth, the production is lower since, as we have said before, the production from failed supernovae is supposed to be less than successful core collapse supernovae in most of the models. Then, in order to evaluate this signal and analyze it on Earth, we need to take into account the opposite process that I have introduced at the start of this presentation, which is the Alps photon conversion in a large coherent magnetic field. In this case, we have evaluated, of course, through a galactical magnetic field model of the Milky Way. And the most important part in this evaluation is that the conversion of probability is related to the galactical magnetic field model that we choose, which is that PA gamma term. At this point, we can compare the expected signal of ALPS converted into gamma rays from Earth, which is the right-hand side one, with the actual data that we have from experiments, which is the one in the left-hand side. As data, we have taken data from Fermi Large Area Telescope that I will express later. In such a way, we can give a morphological bound on the coupling constant GA gamma itself with respect to the axion-like particle mass. So how we have analyzed the Fermilat data? We have used 12 years of Fermilat data peaked at 25 MeV, divided into two main sets. The first one is at energy lower than 200 MeV, and the second one is greater or equal than 200 MeV. Then we have analyzed the astrophysical background that composed the signal, and we have taken different parts, for example, interstellar emission, isotropic diffuse background. But it is important to say that we suppose that the gamma ray emission from sun and moon is supposed to be less than the others. But since these sources of gamma rays are near the Earth, we need to take into account also them. At this point, in order to give the morphological background, the morphological bound on GA gamma, we have divided the sky into three main regions, which are high latitude region, outer galaxy region, and inner galaxy region. And then we have compared them with reference region, which are the so-called patch region, which is the region between with a longitude between minus 105 degrees and 60 degrees, and a latitude, a modulus of the latitude less than 30 degrees. And the whole sky region, which is an overall evaluation. From the data comparison with our expectation, we have given a bound on the parameter space of the ALPS, which is the space where we have GA gamma and the mass, where we have deleted all the part which is above that total systematic uncertainty line. So we I'm using the pointer, we deleted all this red part above this line. In order to give some numbers, let's say that for ultralight axion-like particles with a mass which is, of course, less than 10 to the minus 11 eV, at 95 confidence level, we have that GA gamma is supposed to be less or similar than 3.76 times 10 to the minus 11 GeV. So let's give our conclusion. We have analyzed the dependence of ALPS production with respect to the supernovae model, so the progenitor to the progenitor mass. We have provided analytical fit for the ALPS energy spectrum, and through this we have evaluated the DSNA LPB, so the diffuse supernova LP background, from all core collapse, cosmic core collapse supernovae in the universe. And analyzing this signal and its conversion to gamma rays in the galactical magnetic field, we have determined the bound on the ALPS photon coupling constant GA gamma, which is the one that I have already said, and it is written in the lower part of the slide. So thank you for your attention.